This is an image of the second largest hydrocarbon lake on Titan, called Ligeia, that is located at the North Pole of Titan. This is where most lakes of Titan are. And what this image shows are additional four separate photographs of a coast that has this branching pattern. Close to this complex feature in 2007, there is no island visible next to it. But an image taken in 2013 shows that a radar-bright feature appeared that has this surface area of about 40 kilometers square. That is similar in size to the Manhattan Island. Then, a year later in 2014, the bright feature seemingly mostly vanished. Then, a photo taken 5 months later in 2015 showed that no bright features were present. All of these photographs, in this image, were taken by NASA's Cassini spacecraft. The surface of Titan isn't visible in visible wavelengths from space, so Cassini needed to send radar wavelengths that can penetrate through the hazy atmosphere in order to see the surface and the lakes. The radar wavelengths also managed to penetrate through the liquid methane to a degree. That is why near the shoreline, in some areas, the lake bed of Ligeia is revealed. The maximum depth of the lake was also determined to be around 170 meters. Depth was determined through the amount of time that it took for the radio signal to get back to Cassini. In the largest lake of Titan, Kraken, there are spots that are so deep that the radio signal never bounced back, so exact depth cannot be determined. Now, this is not exactly what Cassini initially captured. These photos are all colorized. The original images captured through radar don't have color. Interestingly, there was also another location where a large feature suddenly appeared out of seemingly nowhere, also in the Lake Ligeia. On the left is a photo captured by Cassini in July of 2013, and it shows no feature in the lake. But a photo captured in August of 2014 shows a pretty large area, about 322 kilometers square, that is quite a bit brighter compared to the rest of the lake, although it is not nearly as bright as the feature captured next to the shoreline in 2013. Still, this feature is about 8 times the size of the one captured in 2013. So then the question is, what are these features? One thing that quickly comes to mind are islands, and due to the fact that these features also appear and disappear quickly, that is why they got the colloquial name of magic islands or mystery islands. It is unlikely that these are islands in a sense of solid ground that was quickly raised from the bottom of the lake. That is because it is very unlikely that solid ground that is so large can appear and disappear in only about a year or so in a relatively deep part of the lake, especially when we know that the bedrock of Titan is water ice, which at temperatures of minus 180 degrees Celsius is much harder compared to water ice on Earth. And it is also much harder than many types of rocks and metals on Earth. It should be mentioned, however, that there are newly formed islands on Earth. Just one of them is the island Surtsey near Iceland. It appeared in the 60s after a few years of volcanic activity. The island popped up from the ground, and it reached its maximum size of 2.7 kilometers square. Currently, after wave erosion, it is about 1.3 kilometers square. Still, even this small island is still here after 60 years. The so-called islands of Titan are also very likely not image artifacts caused from the radar capturing device not capturing what is going on properly. The shoreline is consistent between the photos, proving that the radar device works just fine. Between 2005 and 2009 photos of the Lake Ontario at the South Pole, a change in liquid levels was observed, making the shoreline recess by up to 20 kilometers in some parts. The liquid level probably dropped because the South Pole was entering summer, which increased the evaporation of methane in Ontario. So then, did maybe liquid levels also drop in Ligeia, which then exposed the island in 2013? Between the relevant timeframes, a drop in liquid levels wasn't observed in Ligeia. the shoreline simply didn't recess, so this cannot be the explanation. So then, what are these radar-bright features really? Two likely ideas, which will be discussed later in this video, is that they are bubbles or wave fields. But first, let's start with the idea that the radar-bright features are floating solids. On Earth, there are these events where a volcano submerged in water ejects heated, pressurized rock that is filled with a bunch of gas trapped inside. Because of the gas trapped inside the rock, the overall density of the rock is also low enough to float on water. These rocks can then form massive floating islands that are called pumice rafts. Sometimes they get so large that they can be visible from space. They can take up huge areas similar to the 40-kilometer square bright feature in Ligeia. Eventually, the pumice rocks disperse and the floating rafts disappear, often within a matter of a couple of weeks. The individual pumice rocks also eventually sink, but that can take for years to happen for some rocks. So, is this also what is going on Titan, or something similar? One could interpret the 2014 photo as the floating solids on Titan dispersing from the 2013 raft. However, we don't have good photos between 2013 and 2014 to confirm that these two different bright patches are actually a continuation of the same event. One problem with the idea of floating solids in Ligeia is the fact that the density of liquid methane and ethane on Titan is about half that of water on Earth. So because of the lower density of liquid methane and ethane, there are not nearly as many things that can float on the hydrocarbon lakes of Titan compared to the water oceans and lakes on Earth. Still, that doesn't mean that it is impossible for things to float in Titan's lakes. They would just have to be even less dense than the liquid methane, which not a lot of materials on Titan possess. The most common material on the surface of Titan is water ice. Now, it's not exactly always on the surface, but slightly below it, as Titan is typically coated in a layer of organic material. However, below that, there is plenty of water ice. It's a bedrock. And there are massive regions with exposed water ice. So the water ice chunks would easily sink to the bottom of Titan's lakes due to their density. So they cannot form the temporary islands visible from space. However, that is only if the water ice in question is not porous enough, if it is filled with enough holes and or trapped gas, similar to pumice rock, then the density of water ice chunks could overall drop enough such that they float on the lakes. Titan has cryovolcanoes. They are volcanoes that instead of spewing lava, spew ice. Cryovolcanoes might be able to eject the malleable, heated water ice chunks which have some gas trapped inside. That could then cause them to float and create huge rafts made out of water ice. One potential problem with that is that cryovolcanic activity on Titan is not even close to being on the same level in terms of strength and possibly frequency compared to volcanic activity on Earth. There were only just a few possible cryovolcanoes spotted on Titan, although maybe quite a few more will also be spotted if we ever get higher resolution photos of Titan's surface. If not cryovolcanoes, maybe the origin of potential water ice chunks could be that they somehow detached from the shoreline. Although that isn't very likely, as even lots of different weathering mechanisms likely don't have much of a chance to create large areas of low density water ice on the surface conditions of Titan. That is because the water ice there is extremely hard, and because of that, brittle. That makes water ice not very malleable on the surface. Besides water ice, methane and ethane ice are two other potential candidates for being the floating solids that make up the temporary islands. Maybe these ices could form on the lakes directly once temperatures drop during the night at the poles. Now yes, when both methane and ethane freeze, they contract instead of expand, which means that their density is greater in a solid compared to a liquid form. So methane and ethane ice should sink to the bottom of Titan's lakes. However, if they have enough porosity, they could float in the hydrocarbon lakes, just like water ice could float. In fact, they don't even need to be as porous as water ice to float, due to their density overall being lower than water ice. It should be mentioned that the behavior of methane and ethane being more dense in a solid compared to a liquid form is very much the opposite of how water acts. Water is more dense in a liquid compared to a solid form, which is why water ice floats on liquid water. Besides methane, ethane, and water ice, there aren't many other candidates that can be the potential floating solids in Titan's lakes. That is because there aren't that many different materials present in bulk on the surface. However, of course, the potential floating solids could be some mixture, and it could include some molecules not mentioned. Still, overall, the idea of floating solids needs quite a few conditions in order to occur, and it has some hurdles. Because of that, at least two other simpler ideas have a bit of an advantage over this one. For example, both bubbles and wave fields are simpler explanations for the bright features. And although a simpler explanation doesn't necessarily mean that it is true, it is more likely to be true, as there are not as many conditions and also hurdles in order for regional bubbles or wave fields to appear. Bubbles could appear at the surface of Ligeia through the gas escaping from the lake bed. The gas could originate from a much deeper region in the ice crust or maybe even further below. And yes, given enough bubbles, that would appear bright through radar. So this is a very plausible explanation. This potential gas escaping event could be low-level cryovolcanic activity. Many volcanoes on Earth don't just spew lava, they also spew different gases. As to what the potential composition of the gas escaping is, we can't really say for sure. Maybe it's methane, but in a gas form, coming from deeper, hotter regions where methane isn't a liquid. Methane takes up about 4% of the atmospheric composition near the surface. It is known that methane in Titan's atmosphere should all be converted into other molecules through the interaction with sunlight within 50 million years. Since Titan is about 4.5 billion years old, that means that all of the atmospheric methane should have been long gone. So the potential bubbles in the lakes could be possibly gas methane escaping from the deeper layers, which then replenishes the atmospheric methane. That is all, however, provided that it is even possible for gas methane to reach the surface of the lake before being frozen enough such that it turns into a liquid. Whether or not the gas methane is going to be frozen before reaching the surface probably depends on the depth of the lake bed and also on the energy of the gas. Another possibility is that the gas escaping isn't methane but nitrogen. Nitrogen takes up about 95% of the atmospheric composition near the surface. At temperatures at which methane is liquid, nitrogen is in a gas form. It needs to be a bit colder for nitrogen to start turning into a liquid. So nitrogen gas escaping from deeper ice crust layers certainly wouldn't be frozen enough to turn into liquid by liquid methane. There are, of course, other gases which could be escaping and various mixtures as well. Gas escaping from the bed of a lake, which causes bubbles to appear on the surface of the lake, is also something that occurs on Earth too. So the idea that this also could be happening on Titan, just sometimes on a large scale, isn't all that surprising. Next, what about waves? Just like bubbles, large wave fields are going to appear bright in radar from space. So this is another very simple and plausible explanation for the so-called mystery islands. When the surface of the Lake Ligeia was measured, it was determined to be overall very still. The only waves detected were just a few millimeters tall. Other lakes which were also measured, Ontario and Jingpo, also were extremely still. Throughout half of a year on Titan, which is about 14 Earth years, during the fall and winter periods, wind speeds are typically very weak, at least weak enough such that there are pretty much no waves in the lakes of Titan. However, the bright patches in Ligeia appeared as the North Pole was slowly entering summer, exactly when it is expected for there to be, at times, strong enough winds to generate some waves. Besides wind, there might be other things which could generate wave fields. We likely won't find out what these temporary, radar-bright things really are for a very long time. For one, we know that they don't cover really massive areas, such that they are everywhere. And we also know that they are not super frequent. So even if Dragonfly manages to reach the North Pole of Titan after landing at the equator, even then it likely won't find out what these things really are. Although, of course, there is some chance that it does. Something like a submarine at the lakes of Titan probably has a much better chance of capturing this temporary radar-bright event up close. That is provided that a submarine can travel fast enough, because potentially a submarine would need to travel hundreds of kilometers in order to reach the radar-bright features, which last for a relatively short period of time. Then, if it does that, if they are floating solids, the submarine could potentially determine the composition. If it's a wave field, it could see how waves look like from below on Titan. That is, if there is good enough visibility. And if the radar-bright features are bubbles, it could investigate what part of the lake bed they are coming from. It could look for cracks in the lake bed. And besides that, it could also determine the composition of the gas. Unfortunately, a submarine in these hydrocarbon lakes is a long way from becoming a reality.